Jesus said, "Those who are well need no physician, but those who are sick. I have come not to call the righteous, but sinners." Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Blessed be God's kingdom, now and forever. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us prepare our hearts for the divine mysteries. Let us pray. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear what our Lord Jesus Christ said. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind and with all your strength. This is the great and first commandment, and the second is like it. You shall love your neighbour as yourself. All the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments. Lord, have mercy upon us, and write both these thy laws in our hearts, we beseech thee. Source of all truth, by whose gracious will Saint Matthew became a follower of Christ and exchanged the profits of his tax collecting for the enduring riches of your wisdom, give us the courage to proclaim that same gospel which he made known, so that as ministers of your word we also may discover the true wealth in your kingdom. We ask this through Jesus Christ, who is one with you and the Holy Spirit forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated for the readings.
A reading from the book of Proverbs, chapter 3, beginning at the 13th verse. Happy are those who find wisdom and those who get understanding, for her income is better than silver and her revenue better than gold. She is more precious than jewels, and nothing you desire can compare with her. Long life is in her right hand, in her left hand are riches and honour. Her ways are ways of pleasantness, and all her paths are peace. She is a tree of life to those who lay hold of her. Those who hold her fast are called happy. Hear the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading of a portion of Psalm 119. The response is, happy are those who find wisdom.
Happy are those who find wisdom.
Lord, you have done good to your servant in accordance with your word. O teach me right judgment and knowledge, for I trust in your commandments. Before I was afflicted, I went astray, but now I keep your word. You are good and you do good. O teach me your statutes. Happy are those who find wisdom. The proud have smeared me with lies, but I will keep your precepts with my whole heart. Their hearts are gross like fat, but my delight is in your law. It is good for me that I was afflicted, so that I might learn your statutes. The law of your mouth is dearer to me than a wealth of gold and silver. Happy are those who find wisdom. God, our Comforter, send your Holy Spirit to reveal your hidden mercy, even in our failures and troubles, for the sake of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
A reading from Paul's second letter to the Corinthians, chapter 4, beginning at the first verse. Therefore, since it was by God's mercy that we are engaged in this ministry, we do not lose heart. We have renounced the shameful things that one hides. We refuse to practice cunning or to falsify God's word. But by the open statement of the truth, we commend ourselves to the conscience of everyone in the sight of God. And even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing. In their case, the God of this world has blinded the mind of the unbelievers to keep them from seeing the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. For we do not proclaim ourselves, we proclaim Jesus Christ as Lord and ourselves as your slaves for Jesus' sake. For it is the God who said, let light shine out of darkness, who has shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. Hear the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
We stand for our gradual hymn, O Christ the Lord, O Christ the King.
Thank you.
richer than gold. Jesus Christ, according to St. Matthew, chapter 9, beginning at the 13th verse. Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ. As Jesus was walking along, he saw a man called Matthew sitting at the tax booth, and he said to him, "Follow me." And he got up and followed him. And as he sat at dinner in the house, many tax collectors and sinners came and were sitting with him and his disciples. When the Pharisees saw this, they said to his disciples, "Why does your teacher eat with tax collectors and sinners?" But when he heard this, he said, "Those who are well have no need of a physician, but those who are sick, go and learn what this means. I desire mercy, not sacrifice, for I have come to call not the righteous, but sinners." This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. May I speak to the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Please have a seat. I always quite liked the show, Are You Being Served? Do you know that one? Yeah, Penny knows it. And in the show, if you know it, there is a character called Mr. Humphreys, who was, at the show's start, senior menswear assistant, who would later go on in the show to be the head of the gentleman's department. And something about Mr. Humphreys that one would notice is that he is always well-dressed in expensive suits, jewelry, and apparel. That was because there was a time when, and some of you would probably remember, people who sold suits would make a commission. If you remember Reuben F. Scarf, who are no longer in business, sort of did away with that with the budget suit. My first job, funnily enough, was actually at Meyer Charlestown, which used to be Grace Brothers. You'd go out the back to the stockroom and all the boxes would have Grace Brothers printed on it. And when I was working at Meyer, people who'd been there a long time would remember the outrageous commissions of the suit salesmen in the past. The more they would charge, the more that went into their back pocket. They made more money if they sold it to you at a higher price. Now, back in the day, salesmen were known to wear like Giorgio Armani or Dolce and Gabbana suits they themselves would wear and sell. Some of the best, I'm told, wore Rolex watches and Breitling, if you know another very high-end brand that was very popular during the time, and Gucci shoes. These men dressed the part to sell you the part. But you may be thinking, Zeb, where does this all fall within today's reading, Suit Salesman at Charlestown? Well, today we are celebrating the feast of St. Matthew, who was a tax collector, a job that allowed the person to collect taxes on behalf of the Roman Empire, and if they were able to collect more than required, they were able to keep the difference. Put it in their back pocket. Making them quite unliked amongst the local Jewish population. And if Matthew was to be dressed in anything when he met with Jesus in today's reading, it would have been the Armani suit with the Rolex and the Gucci shoes, because he lived the high life. Then Jesus said to him, he called to him, "Follow me." We all, I think, in our lives have the temptation to be the pre-discipleship Matthew, the tax collector Matthew, the suit salesman Matthew. And what I mean is that before Matthew had experienced Jesus, he worshipped something else. And the way he dressed, acted, or engaged with others would have been to the glory of that other thing. Here could be an example. The clothes that we wear have a meaning to us, right? What do your clothes say about you? I enjoy a Oxford cloth button-down because I think it looks a bit nicer than a tie, but that comes with a particular culture. They're very popular in south of the States, in places like Texas, right? I also enjoy bluegrass music, which also comes from the south in America. So you're starting to get this image that what I wear is popular in a particular context and it communicates something about me. What do the things that you wear communicate about you? Some purchase name brands to communicate wealth. But on the flip side, I also know people who purposefully purchase low-end clothing because they want to be seen as frugal or savvy. Yesterday, I went to Spears Point, quite interestingly enough, before this was all put together, well, after this was all put together, and in it we went to, there was a sustainability festival at Spears Point. They were giving away two free plants to Lake Macquarie City Council residents, and unfortunately I live in Newcastle, just on the border. But that's neither here or there. But what I found is when I was there, because of the culture that is in that environment, people dressed a particular way. It's like Woodstock never finished. But it communicates something about how they want to be seen. They're not dressing expensive. Well, actually, most of it was pretty expensive, but it didn't look like it was. So then you have people who desire to be seen in a particular thing, but at both ends of the spectrum. But the interesting part is, however, in the end, they still up at the same issue. They worship something else. But yet, are the other things that you can or we can worship give you value, meaning, and connection or purpose? Or rather, do they create a haze that leads to our divergence from Jesus? Do we worship money or our lack of it? There's some people that profess very proudly, with great pride, that they have very little income because they worship that image. Do we worship family or even the idea of it? Many of you remember Val, or some of you would remember Val Roach, my great aunt, who was a member of this parish for years, who struggled to have children, who ended up adopting and did end up having their own. But the pressure placed on her to have a family was tremendous, and she couldn't. Do we worship the good works and the desire for people to see us as good and nice people? There are plenty more I can list, but the important part is that these things can distract us from the call placed on our lives to follow me, to follow Christ. One thing I think we often forget is the magnitude of which the disciples got up and left everything behind. If Jesus came back tomorrow, try and look a bit busy, but could you get up and leave everything that you have behind? And I ask this in a genuine way, because I too need to ask myself this. Could you walk away? Could I walk away from everything? Because Jesus has called you and I to follow him, to follow me. I can almost imagine myself and possibly other people, and you could maybe imagine yourself looking back at Jesus and going, what, me? Calling me? In that state of shock. Do you, Jesus, expect me to drop everything and come with you? I've got work tomorrow. I have appointments at the optometrist at 3 p.m. on Wednesday. And people are expecting this of me. I have to do them. But this is the challenging part and the rude awakening that we often forget. Jesus doesn't care about any of that. Do you think he cared that Matthew had to collect taxes the next day? No. Did he care that the sons of Zebedee had to do fishing with their father?
No.
All the things that we do mean nothing to the one who brought the universe into being just by an act of his grace. This grace that he gives to us means that if we want a spiritual renewal from him, if we want to know him, feel him, see him, we too must remember that it is not our work in the world of being good and nice people that helps us see Jesus. All the rosary barbecues in the world will not help you see Jesus. All the fundraising for PNC will not see you see Jesus. Nothing outside of him will help you or I see Christ, whether that is the one or is the other things that we grasp to, the things that diverge us from him, or being good and nice people to the world's standards. God desires for everyone to be saved. The scriptures tell us that directly from it. Even those who, like Matthew, in his earlier life, held to things that separated him from God, that separated you from God, that separates us from God. A life, whether he realized it or not, beforehand separated him from the only thing that could give him true value, meaning, and purpose and connection. Because Jesus knows that anything else we worship, whether we believe it is good or not, acts as something that is of merit. All other things besides Jesus position themselves as merit because it becomes then a competition leading people to feel like they deserve more, they need more to achieve, to be rewarded more, leading to a state of dysfunction. Quick example. Those who are younger probably may remember the joys of high school, and in year 12 you do your HSE. And they give you a UAI, ATAR, some sort of number. How do you get that number? By doing exams, right? How do they grade your number? That's the interesting part. Is anyone familiar here with Hunger Games? Yeah, some of us. So in Hunger Games, they pick people and pit them against each other, and the strongest one standing is the last one alive, and they all kill each other. Our system of education pits children against each other because they're not ranked based on their score against a standard. They are ranked based on how they did against their peers. So those who are higher beat all the other kids. Those who are lower had a lot of others do better than them. The question becomes is, why don't we look at it at the grade and the ability of the person? Because our system is geared on merit. So much in our world is based on merit. That promotion you may want, the position you want in a community organization. Our society is based on merit, which leads to dysfunction and a disconnection with people and society. We must approach Jesus not in these games of merit, but rather through joyful grace. But what is joyful grace? Grace is something like an unmerited gift. It is a gift from God, from Jesus, not because of anything you can do. So when we say joyful grace, it means to receive that gift from God Not like a 10-year-old getting socks for Christmas. Oh, thanks. Have you ever given socks to a kid for Christmas? No. I've seen it happen. They're usually not very appreciative. But the reality is, with joyful grace, what happens if you realize the only thing you need is socks and someone gives you socks? You're going to be pretty happy, aren't you? And that is how we must receive the gift. Not like a child who's spoiled and thinks it has everything, but as a child who needs what the gift is. Because that gift is relationship with God. And that is through that gift we find spiritual renewal. We see Jesus and he sees us. Not seeing us as people who have to scramble to be top dog. You don't have to fight to win God's love. He loves us all the same. To earn his favor by our merit, our deeds or our acts, but rather as people who are his children receiving the most amazing gift of all. One that has been given to us with nothing that we can do, all because we followed him. Jesus called Matthew to follow him, and his life is changed. And in the same way, Jesus calls you to follow him. And if you choose to follow him, your life will be changed too. The call of Jesus is not only the one of the mind, knowing the information. It's a call on also the body, what we do, and the soul, how we are. Seeing a transformation of life, all responding to that call of follow me. One could translate his call as maybe be an apprentice to me. Luckily for us, we're always an apprentice. We don't just get 3 years to perfect our trade. Or walk as I walk, think as I think, choose as I choose, see as I see. This call from Jesus is about discipleship, a discipleship that entails an entire reworking of ourself by the power of him who calls us by name, who is our value, meaning, and purpose and connection. There's a great hymn called Who is on the Lord's Side? I encourage you to listen to it. It's a really good one. And in it, it calls us to make that decision to follow him. We can choose to not to. We can choose to follow him if we wish to. I know I've probably used it a bit too much, but I talk often about reciprocal love. I was at Kmart the other day picking up something for someone, and I was in the toy section. Actually, no, I was there to get a money tin, that's right, and they didn't have any. But I was in the kids' toy section because that's where they said they were. And in there, you can buy a $29 robot dog. $29, PJ. Can you believe it? See if he's listening. But yet there was a store shelf completely full of them, and yet other stuff of things around it were completely gone. There was no money tins. But these robot dogs were plenty of them. Why is that? Well, you can buy them now. You don't have to have a real dog anymore. You have to just, you know, put batteries in it. Doesn't make any mess. Doesn't run around the skirting boards of your house. Doesn't, you know, dig at the lounge or around the house or leave messes everywhere. But yet they're not there. Why is that? Because the desire, we as things made in the image of God desire relationship, don't we? We want to be loved and loved. Anything that is forced to love us is made to love us. Kids get bored of real quickly. So do we. God desires for you in your free will to follow him. Like a real dog. They don't have to love us. They usually are pretty forgiving. I know my dogs are. But they're not made or forced to. In the same way, just as you want to be loved by those who love you because they choose to, not because they're forced to. God in Jesus wants you to love him, to change your life, to invite him in by the power of the Spirit, not because we're forced to, because you want to. I remember at the start of the year, I was, we don't talk about how we're feeling about stuff very often as clergy, But I was pretty depressed. And one thing is, if you want to see through that, there is opportunity, but you have to take up the mantle. What do I mean by that? You have to do things like, you know, I always love when I go visit people and they've got a Bible and it's got about 2 or 3 mils of dust sitting on it. It's a very good place to sit it, you know, it looks pretty nice on the bookshelf. A good Bible is a used Bible. Are you reading the scriptures? Are you praying? It just has to be 5 minutes a day. It doesn't have to be a long hour, you know, set of prayers. It can be something short and sweet. Are you talking about God in your life? And the reason I bring this up is we have a new little resource. If anyone wants a copy, and if we've run out, I'll print out more because there was a lot taken this morning, called Finding God in Anxiety and Depression. Let me commend it to you. It was a little thing that is made up of other resources and bits and pieces that I used when I was going through a hard time. It's yours free to take, so you don't have to pay for all the resources like I did. But it's a little helpful, handy thing that will help transform your journey to be focused on Him who actually cares about you. The world mocks you as you bow down to the stuff that's in it. Christ elevates you and lifts you up. So my prayer this week is that we don't be like Mr. Humphreys or like things that we worship and, you know, make us bow down to them and they mock us, but rather we can be people who are elevated and glorified through our love of Christ so that we may be transformed and by our transformation transform the world. Amen. Let us together affirm the faith of the church. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of His Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Ghost of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day He rose again according to the scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of the Father, and He shall come again with glory to judge both the quick and the dead, whose kingdom shall have no end. And I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceedeth from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who speaks pray for the world and for the church. Please sit or kneel as able.
Let us pray to God, who brings sinners to repentance and new life. As you have founded the church on the teaching of the apostles, grant that she may faithfully hold and make known the traditions which they taught. Give to all Christian people grace in their time to follow the example of your apostle, Matthew, whom we commemorate today. Keep the church firm against temptation to compromise the faith for the sake of outward success. Deeply mindful of our own sins, may we always be open to receive into our fellowship the outcast and the despised. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
We pray for all who control the wealth of the nations, all who deal in money transactions across the world. Bless with integrity and honest service those responsible for taxation. May the light of the resurrection faith shine in the world where vision is limited and hope is faint, where races and nations fall apart in dissension. Make them secure on the firm foundation of your love. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Keep us, our families and friends, constant in faith. Protect us from error and make us messengers of the good news to those with whom we live and work. In all that we do, shield us from the evil that springs from love of money. Make us honest in our debts and generous in our giving. Bless those in our community who are seeking the way back from the errors of their lives. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Have compassion on those who have been led astray by false doctrine and restore them to purity of faith. Release those who by seeking forbidden knowledge have fallen into the power of evil. Have mercy on those who have fallen into debt and can find no escape. Help them to return to wise and secure living. Soften the hearts of any who oppress the poor and put gain before mercy. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
We pray for all who have passed through the temptations of this world and come to their rest. Grant that when we are called from this life with Mary, Mother of our Lord, Saint Joseph, her spouse, Saint Matthew, and all the saints, we may be pardoned for our sins and rejoice in your company in the heavenly kingdom. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer. Lord God, let the Christian people rejoice that in Christ's body we are members one of another. And let our prayer lead the whole church to share in the glory of your holy apostles. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, you have promised to hear our prayers. Grant that what we have asked in faith, we may by your grace receive. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear what comfortable words our Saviour Christ said to all who truly turn to him. Come to me all who are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Hear also what St. Paul said, "The saying is sure and worthy of full acceptance that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners." Hear also what St. John said, "But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, and he is the atoning sacrifice for our sins." Let us pray. We do not presume to come to your table, merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table, but you are the same Lord, whose nature is always to have mercy. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that we may evermore dwell in him, and he in us. Amen. Christ calls us to share the heavenly banquet of his love with all the saints in earth and heaven. Let us then run our race, laying aside every weight, and bringing our sins to the Lord in penitence and faith. Merciful God, our Maker and our Judge, we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, and in what we have failed to do. We have not loved you with our whole heart, We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. We repent and are sorry for all our sins. Father, forgive us. Strengthen us to love and obey you in newness of life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, who has promised forgiveness to all who turn to him in faith, pardon you and set you free from all your sins, strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Would you please stand? We are the body of Christ.
His Spirit is with us.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
We share God's peace together with those who are here and those who join us online. Brothers and sisters, let me remind you that St. John wrote, "How does God's love abide in anyone who has the world's goods and sees a brother or sister in need and yet refuses help?" Our offertory hymn is "He Sat to Watch O's Customs Paid." For through your goodness we have this bread to offer, which earth has given and human hands have made. It will become for us the bread of life. Blessed be God forever. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have this wine to offer, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. It will become our spiritual drink. Blessed be God forever. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have this gift of our labour. Accept and use this offering for your glory and for the service of your kingdom. Blessed be God forever. Generous God, whose table is prepared for us, we ask you that as your Son was pleased to be a guest in Matthew's house, so Christ may make this gathering a place of reconciliation and peace to your glory forever and ever. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always here and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, in Christ your Son reveal your compassion for humankind, and in mercy you invite sinners to sit at the banquet of your kingdom. Saint Matthew responded to the call of Christ and made him welcome in his house, changed and renewed by the coming of the Lord. He dedicated himself to proclaim your wonderful works of salvation. To his preaching of the gospel, we respond with gladness, joining all the powers of heaven in this their ceaseless hymn of praise. Gracious God, all creation rightly gives you praise. All life, all holiness comes from you through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, whom you sent to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. Hear us, merciful Lord, through Christ, accept our sacrifice of praise, and by the power of your word and Holy Spirit, sanctify this bread and wine, that we who share in this holy sacrament may be partakers of Christ's body and blood, who, when his hour had come on the night before he went up to the cross to make a full atonement for the sins of the whole world, offering once for all his one sacrifice of himself, took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." The mystery of faith. We proclaim thy death, O Lord, and profess thy resurrection. his command, we commemorate and celebrate his saving passion and death, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension into heaven, and eagerly await his coming again in glory. We thank you that by your grace alone you have accepted us in Christ, and here we offer you a spiritual sacrifice, holy and acceptable in your sight. Through Christ receive this our duty and service, and grant that we who eat and drink these holy gifts may by your Holy Spirit be one body in Christ and serve you in unity and peace. Gracious God, renew the life of your church. Remember Peter, our bishop, and all ministers who break and share the living bread among us. Remember those broken in body or spirit. Give them peace in the glorious wounds by which we have been healed. In your grace and mercy, bring us to the joy of your eternal kingdom with all the company of the redeemed. May we praise you in union with them and give you glory through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, gracious Father, forever and ever. Amen. As our Savior Christ has commanded and taught us, we are bold to say, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Break this bread to share in the body of Christ. We who are many are one body, for we all share in the one bread. O Lamb of God, that takest away the sins of the world, have mercy upon us. God, who takes away the sins of the world. Happy are those who are called to his supper.
Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed.
Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast. Come, let us take this holy sacrament of the body and blood of Christ in remembrance that he died for us, and feed on him in our hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Keep you in eternal life.
you in eternal life. The body of Christ keep you in eternal life. The body of Christ keep you in eternal life. The body of Christ keep you in eternal life.
Jesus said, "Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you." Let us pray. O God, who makes us partakers in the same joy with which St. Matthew welcomed the Saviour, nourish us with the food of Christ, who came to call not the righteous but sinners. We ask this in the name of our teacher and redeemer for ever and ever. Father, we offer ourselves to you as a living sacrifice through Jesus Christ our Lord. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Great to see you all. I hope you come over for a coffee at least afterwards, or you know, say goodbye at the door at least before you run off. Any birthdays, anniversaries or anything like that? No? Wonderful. We'll finish up and I'll see you at the door. Would you please stand for the blessing? God give you grace to follow St. Matthew and all the saints in faith and hope and love. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ.
Amen. And our final hymn, Be Thou My Vision.